respected panelists. First off, we have Advocate Shivi Sanyam. He had worked as a judicial law clerk cum research assistant with Justice J.S. Khehar, Supreme Court of India. He also had worked as a research assistant at Chambers of Dr. Birendra Saraf. He worked as a paralegal at Chambers of Advocate Zal Andhya Rujina. Next up, we have Advocate Ashutosh Shukla. He has worked as a law clerk cum research assistant in the Supreme Court of India. He is an advocate at Karanjwala and Company, and previously he had worked with Shukla and Company Advocates. I thank you both for sparing your time and coming here. And before we start with the session, for the students, I would like to say learn and ask and make the most of this opportunity. And now we can commence with the session. Can we have a big round of applause for them before we start?
So we'll just outline this for you. I think both of us will first just give you a brief of about our experience and maybe share a little bit more about how it was for some of our friends who were clerking with different judges at either High Court or the Supreme Court. And after that, whatever questions you have, we'll answer those. You want to start?
No, you go ahead.
So I...
Okay. So I started immediately after my college. So I went to GLC. And in GLC, one of the advantages that you have is that you get to work simultaneously while you're in college, because our lectures happen in the morning. And you can attach yourselves to law firms over there. If you are inclined towards counsel practice, you can attach yourself with them. And you can learn during that process of 5 years as to how things are happening in court. So most of us, most of the people that went there would have extensively interned all throughout. They would be paralegal at law firms for decent amount of time, and then they would attach themselves in teams wherever they're more interested. So I got done with my course in 2015. I started clerking at the Supreme Court. And so my personal experience was a bit different. And I think it will be that way for most of the individuals, because each one of those judges function in a very different manner. So one thing that I would recommend is that when you're choosing to clerk at Supreme Court or at High Court, you must know how the judge functions with their law clerks. Because there would be certain judges who would not interact at all. So you're just there. There might be something which will someday come to you, maybe a research or a note or something, but your interaction at certain offices is almost negligible. So I've had friends who've had that experience at some of the places. So then they waited and then they switched or they went for another option. Then there are offices where oral briefings also happen. In Supreme Court, I'm sure all of you are aware, they have miscellaneous matters. So a lot of the work which was happening at the time in 2015 to 16 for most of the law clerks was to prepare either notes for those miscellaneous matters on Monday, Friday. There was also, of course, assisting them on their hearing matters. But primarily, a lot of the clerks were doing this work. I was fortunate I didn't have to, because the way my boss functioned was that if you spend your time doing this, reading everything, then you won't really learn much. That was his suggestion, which frankly worked out well for me. He said that whatever interest that you really have, you pick those, and those are the ones which we'll discuss together, and those are the ones on which you can have your assignments. I was very fortunate because he had a couple of really good matters going on, so I got to witness some of the best legal points being argued. One of the best senior advocates that you will see in the country were all there at the time. And you can ask specific questions eventually, whatever you have. So the way he functioned was this, but there were certain other judges who also took oral briefings. So you would prepare that note, you would sit in with them, and you would brief them on the matter. So that is the kind of learning which is very different. There were some judges who were offering that. So I think the crucial aspect is that you must know how the judge functions. Otherwise, you'll end up having you'll waste an entire year over there, because your minimum, I think they take you for 6 months and then a year. I think the only difference between High Court and Supreme Court as such is about the nature of the work. But again, you have to be aware of which person you're going to work with. There are great options at both the places, Supreme Court as well as High Court. A lot of people, I think, are attracted to Supreme Court because, of course, some of them are planning it from the perspective of going for their masters, and that counts more. And in most situations, it would. But I think from your learning perspective, some of the judges at High Court also are extraordinary. So apart from that, the work which for me, which it involved was that I got to go to court almost every other day and attend all the hearings, discuss those aspects with him. If I had any input, if a query was put in, you could always go back and discuss it with him. My boss was available for that aspect. And so he was an extremely hardworking individual. Like, I saw him work harder than any other person that I would have known 40 years younger than him. And not just about me, because I knew other people who were working far harder than I was. And initially when I had started, because I already knew that they like these notes being prepared on miscellaneous brief, whether it's a one pager or so, and because I had interned extensively in Bombay, so I prepared something and I kept it in his file. But when he saw it, his response was, see, you don't have to do this. And so later on also I tried that, and he said that, see, you might think that you will do a better job than me because you have nothing else to do, but it's my job and I'll do it. You pick things that you like and those are the ones which we'll interact on. So eventually I started getting my assignments on the matters that he was hearing, and he was going to lay down something new. So that again I think became a very interesting area. And he would sit with you, he would go through that research whenever he gets time, and then he will pick things that he may use or he may not use. He wouldn't tell you at the time, but he'll tell you, okay, this is good. And then eventually when it comes out, he'll tell you, okay, yeah, in that one, I think view something, you should see how, if you like it. So that way he was extremely generous. So again, it again differs from person to person. There can be judges who have appreciated their clerks in court sometimes. So that sort of becomes the high point. Some would do that when you ask for a reco, and then you would get a really nice reco, so you would know. But yeah, apart from that, I would say that it's a really extraordinary opportunity. I'm not sure which colleges you're all from here. There was a time when this opportunity was only there for National Law School people. And then eventually it opened and they introduced the exam also. Though even right now, the exam is not really considered that important because they need someone who has experience. And while a lot of individuals can clear the exam, they may not be best suited for how the judge functions and how he likes things. So I know that a lot of them would prefer people who already have some experience, who worked before either with a law firm or with counsels and who have their basics right. I think I'll pass it on to him now, and whatever questions you guys have, we'll take those.
Yeah, before I start, I'll just add to what he said. I completely agree with most judges preferring people with experience. It's sort of counterproductive because there is an exam in place. So while you might feel it's unfair because there is an exam and people get selected and those people need to be chosen to work with the individual judges, a lot of judges that I know also want some people with at least 4 years experience, 5 years experience. So it's not just a mere 1 or 2 years experience. Because at the end of the day, I would also like to say that for the past 3-4 years, this whole concept of clerkship has evolved quite a bit as compared to what it was earlier. So now the judges are taking a more personal role in both mentoring and grooming the clerks, as well as in their involvement with the judicial work. Now about myself, I am a 2016 graduate from NUJS. I then practiced for 2 years in Calcutta, before the Calcutta High Court, the district courts. And then I made a switch to Delhi. And over here, I joined Justice Indu Malhotra, and I was working for her. Now, like he pointed out, choosing the judge is very important. I had zero plans of doing a judicial clerkship. I was just looking out for job opportunities here. But because of Justice Malhotra's reputation as a lawyer, as well as a mentor, when I figured there's a vacancy there, I wished to apply. Work-wise, while he has given you a broad overview of the different kind of works that are there, personally for me, Justice Malhotra focused a lot on the daily briefings that used to happen. So she would it would go to such an extent that we would get feedback on our briefs. And back then we would be really frustrated, but now that I'm in the profession and actually briefing seniors, in hindsight I realize how that was immensely helpful. So one of the things she was very particular about is oral briefings. So you had to prepare a one pager or a two pager and then brief her orally. And this she used to do for every matter. And there are other judges who do that. And there are some judges who would just want their clerks to put in a note and then they'll read it on their own. There are some judges who will be involved, who will involve their clerks during the judgment writing part as well. Research you get during that part. I was fortunate because I got opportunity of both ways, because when I had joined, Justice Malhotra was part of the Constitution bench, the one that was hearing 377, Sabrimala, adultery, etc. So back then we also got some very interesting research propositions. And the good thing about her, like about working for that particular office, was that the involvement of the clerks was very integral. So she made it a point to sit down with all of us weekly and, you know, what were the important matters that came up in court? What were the important judgments that happened? And she made it a point to make sure that she's as invested in our professional growth as we are in the work that we are doing for her. So that way, I think my choice of Justice Malhotra paid off, but which is why you really need to figure out who you want to clerk for. There are offices where you will just go do your basic work and get out of there and you'll get a certificate in the end of it. But it's important to know what you want out of it. If you just want a certificate, if you just want it on your CV, then I mean, probably it's a good idea for you. But this is a great opportunity if you look at it. It's one of the major benefits, other than obviously the exposure to various files, various kinds of applications, drafting styles, etc., is that you also tend to figure out what is it that the judges are looking for in a particular argument. So you may have very complex matters, but those will hinge on maybe two or three questions. And because you're discussing this, you know which those questions are. And that sort of stays with you. So when you're doing your own matters, you can figure out that, yeah, these are the things that probably that person would be looking for. Again, this would differ from judge to judge widely in our Supreme Court, but even then, it's a very good training ground. And the other misconception that there is that the judicial clerkship is done only to get an LLM degree. I know when I joined this stint, everyone asked me, why do you have plans for an LLM? You're 2 years into the practice, et cetera, et cetera. I had no plans back then. I have no plans now. But this I just wanted to do for the experience and the exposure that it gets. And in both these aspects, it's been extremely fulfilling. But before joining any office, it is integral that you do your research. Because the idea is not just to have a one-year stint and be done with it. The idea is to have an enriching experience for a year where you can build relationships, not just with the judge concerned, but also with your fellow clerks, with clerks who are working with other judges. So, because at the end of the day, the legal profession is very community-based, right? So you have to keep all these non-tangible things in mind as well. So I think we can now ask whatever specific questions you guys have.
It's definitely an experience that I think you should definitely pursue, regardless, like he said, whether you want an LLM or not, whether you want a firm job or not. It would definitely help you, because I think to see these individuals work, especially if you pick well, and even if you don't have an opportunity, you still get to see it. Because see, in that court, they now have around 34, 35 people. It just increased 3 or 4.
Yeah.
So even if, let's say, you're attached to a judge who may not take that kind of an interest in what you're doing, he would probably be sitting with someone who's extraordinary. And that experience would, again, teach you a lot.
Exactly. Just and to add to, yeah. I'm sorry. So Justice Lalit was the presiding judge for a good part of my stint when I was with Justice Malhotra. And while I know very little about criminal law, the roster was primarily criminal law. And the file portion made me research and study criminal law. The other aspect of it was Justice Lalit being brilliant in criminal law. His courts were such an enriching experience in learning, in figuring out the process, in figuring out which are the important questions to look for. And that just buttresses what he said, that you, it's not just about your judge or what you learn in the office, but it's about going to court and figuring out, learning from everyone there.
So what college are you guys from? Are any of you from National Law School? None of you. Okay, you're all from colleges in and around Delhi, I'm guessing then. Hyderabad, okay. Which college? Symbiosis, Amity, IP, WIPS, all right. So another point that I'd like to add, I'm not sure how much you'd like it, is that when you're not from an institution which is of great repute or which has had a history or a legacy, then something like a clerkship really helps. Because the minute you put yourself in that space and you're interacting with one of the finest minds, you're getting to watch one of the best people, and that thing comes on your profile, any other step that you will make forward will also help. A firm will also, consider you more. That's happened with a lot of people. And even chambers would, if you've actually spent a lot of time over there, because you're learning at that, in both of these places, whether it's Supreme Court or High Court, I think is exponential. If you really take an interest and if you take initiative. Because, so just when I was there was another intern who was like a long-term intern. And it was about the initiative. So when my boss saw that I was taking more initiative, I got more of an audience with him. So that is also something that you will have to keep in mind, that it's fine. At worst, what will happen is that they'll say no. But you must take that initiative and approach them for work. If you've heard something in court, and if you think there is some input that you can add, go and meet them when they arrive after court or something of that sort. Eventually, they will see that, okay, fine, you're interested in learning, and they'll try to help you out. So yeah, now if you have any specific questions, whether with regard to High Court, because I've had interactions with a couple of my friends who clerked over there, or at the Supreme Court, we can take questions. Personally, I think the best time to clerk there was a little while ago, because things at the court right now are bit too haywire, and you can call it that. But regardless, I think when you will see, for me, when I saw individuals like Mr. Nariman or Mr. Arvind Datar, Mr. Sibbal, Dr. Singhvi, Mr. Rohatgi, K.K. Venugopal, all of these individuals were arguing before you, so it was like being schooled. And in GLC, we didn't really have a very classroom kind of an experience. Because the college functions in a very different manner. So most of our learning was either from our seniors or from the members of the bar with whom we were working continuously. So when you get an opportunity like this, it was literally like being schooled on, let's say, separation of powers or independence of judiciary from the individuals who know the subjects best in the country. And they were offering contesting views. So I would definitely recommend that all of you pursue it whenever you're getting done with your college. Whether it's for a year, whether it's for 2 years, you must definitely consider a clerkship. Questions?
Yeah.
We'll share this one, you can use this.
Yeah.
So as you said, a clerkship is a minimum of 6 months and then a year extended. So would you say there is specifically something to gain from a clerkship compared to an internship under the set?
Judges.
You can go for a month or two in an internship.
So again, the difference is in the way interns and clerks are treated in the office. There are some offices where they're both given the same responsibilities, and there are some offices where the responsibilities are vastly different. If your office is one like that, then interning there would pretty much be pointless, right? But if your office is one where the responsibilities broadly given are the same, then an internship would also, like, it's then it becomes a technical difference, right, between a clerkship and an internship. The other very important thing that he had pointed out is about initiative. And that's true not just for clerkship, but also for any other job or internship you go to. There are places which have very bad reviews amongst interns. Kaam nahi milta hai, feedback nahi milta hai. But there are interns who have performed exceedingly well in those places. And the only difference that has been there is those interns have taken the initiative to either take on more work or hound the partners or associates for feedback. So that has to be there, right?
It's a very simple thing. When the duration is the same, 6 months, then why would you rather be called an intern and not a law clerk or a research assistant? So obviously clerkship is more preferable because that holds more value. And you get paid. And the amount is now, I think, around 50,000.
A month.
It's more than
a month,
that.
Yeah. It's more than that? Yeah, he knows better because he did it right now.
I got that, but now it's been revised.
It's been revised again. It's been revised. During our time, it was less, but I think it's more than 50,000 now. So that's more than any other, most of the litigation chambers which will pay you anywhere in the country, by the way, except a few senior advocates and a few generous filing officers.
So you mentioned that a judge prefers someone who has work experience before. So in work experience, what are they actually looking for? If a person, say you, for example, started your clerkship immediately after your LLB, right? So if a person is well, like the exam has the five main subjects are being covered, constitutional law, then your CPC, CRPC, evidence, and all these things. So if a person is preparing for all these subjects, are they sufficient? No.
What will happen is you will clear the exam. You will go for the interview, you will clear the interview. Then you'll be in the pool. And then eventually when there is a vacancy, you will get a call, okay, fine, that this judge has requested a clerk and you're the next rank holder. Go, join. And you'll start there. But I'm just letting you know, so I started straight away. But I had already worked those 5 years of my law school. So I was already looking to do things which were expected of me. And so that's the main difference. Because see, during my time also, a lot of people who were applying for clerkship, the exam just started from that year in 2015 and 15, 16 or so. So a lot of those individuals were preparing for judiciary, your exams for district judiciary. And most of those individuals were equipped to clear exams. So some of them very easily cleared the clerkship exam and then they continue to prepare for that exam. But those individuals may or may not be. Some of them were. A couple of them are judges now, and they did a fabulous job for the judges they were working with. Their judges were relying on them quite a bit. But I'm just letting you know that there are judges who would prefer that you have worked before. He did it after 2 years of work X. So he'd done a lot of filing work for 2 years, and then he came to do his clerkship. So the judge also would be able to, you know, receive more from you. You'll be able to add more value. It's basically because you have more knowledge, so that's the basic aspect. I would still say that you should consider it. If you clear it and you get it very well, go right away. But if you have an option, then you can consider that you get some experience. I'm telling you, one of the finest judges who's there in the court right now, without a doubt, he prefers people with work X. So that's there. I can't take his name, but I'll just tell you, like, the one of the phrases which was used was, the registry sends me all sorts of trash. So that mindset's already there. Because see, if you don't have work X, you may or may not be of value to me. And sometimes they might, but most of the time which they did send was something that he could not work with. So those people were just there. And they're allowed to take clerks on discretion. So that's what they would then prefer. But ultimately they have to get their work done. Next, anyone else?
Just to add to this, the difference here is about having technical competency and having some sort of practical exposure. When you go work for a judge, they really don't have the time to sit down and clear your basics, right? And basics are not just what's there in the section, but it's a lot about how pleadings are done, what are the important aspects of a file, right? So file reading is a skill in itself. And these are things that you will only pick up once you start working. So while he did it right after graduation, because he was in GLC and he had interned extensively, he had that sufficient work X, right? I had 2 years of work X, and I was told explicitly that I was being chosen because of my experience for 2 years. So that then becomes an important factor. Any other question?
So is work ex also to be in some specific field of law, some specialization, anything? Like, should a student like direct or?
No, there's nothing like that. There are people who are working in a corporate law firm and then they shifted and they did a clerkship, then they studied there, then they went for a LLM. There's no clear structure in this profession as such.
Okay.
You could be doing anything at that point of time and still excel it. I think it's more about the work ethic that you develop while working at either a chamber or a firm. And then, of course, with time, automatically. It's not that they expect you to know everything. It's not like that. It's just that you'd be able to take on those assignments in a more proper manner than you would otherwise be, because otherwise you'd be clueless.
Thank you.
Ask us anything that you want. You can ask anything which is basic. You don't have to think if it's a good enough questions or anything. Specific to your scenario also.
Okay.
Yeah, go on, ask 10 more. That's what we're here for.
Okay, if the focus is on gaining work experience, say I am in my final year and I'll have 6 months in hand, the last semester is given just to intern. So, should I do a judicial internship or under a lawyer to be able to be in a position that I
see? So now that's very valuable for you. You could consider, because now you don't have attendance, I'm guessing last semester,
yes,
they allow you to do
exactly.
it.
Exactly.
You could consider working continuously with a judge. You could apply to one of those individuals you're interested in working with, or wherever you get in. You can apply to multiple places and then see. And once you show them that you're really, really diligent and you're interested and you're taking, you can then, when you're leaving, you can ask them that, I would like to join you as a law clerk after I get done. In between, after a month, after 2 months, anytime. That is a choice.
Interning under a judge would be better than interning.
I wouldn't say better or worse. It's a personal choice. If, let's say, you want a job in a firm, I would recommend that you consider doing that. That you could go and work at that firm, show them how good or valuable you can be, and then they would give you an offer. And then you'd work at that firm. But if it is something that makes you curious, that, let's say, you want to do litigation, for example, I would recommend clerkship in general also, but I would definitely recommend it for people who are considering litigation, because I think it's an added advantage. You're only giving 1 year out of your life, and it's something that you can't really do later on. It's probably just like first 4 or 5 years of your professional life after college. So it's a choice that you have to make. I think you can go there, work with them. If you're getting to work with them for 3-4 months, that I think has a lot of value. And then they can consider you if they can have you for later on as well. Definitely makes sense.
There was a question.
Is there any particular aspect which
you want?
Clerkship. So I think it's minimum 6 months at Supreme Court. You will sign a contract for 6 months, or you will sign it for a year. And it's, I mean, at judge's discretion, they can extend it as well if you want to do it for longer. I have a couple of friends who did it for a year and a half, 2 years. There are people, one of them who was supposed to be here today, did it for 3 years with a particular judge. Varied experiences. She even got to, one of the person that I know, even got to write judgments. So differs from person to person. But yeah, the duration is something 6 months to a year mostly. Nothing?
So can you tell us more about the clerkship exam and the interview? Like, what should we focus on?
So I didn't go through that process, because I applied before the exam came, and then I pursued it, and I got through. Exam as such has those subjects which you have to prepare. I think five, right? Evidence, IPC, CRPC, CPC, and constitutional law. Once you clear, you get ranks, and then they'll call you, like a shortlisted students, according to their vacancies at the time. They'll call you for interview. Mostly 2 or 3 judges of the Supreme Court will take that interview. And then there could be any question. It could depend on your personal profile. They could ask you about the work that you've done. They could ask you about something that's happening in the country recently. One of the verdicts of the court earlier, they might ask you if, let's say, you came from a Northeast or Kashmir or Rajasthan, anything. And if they wanted to ask you something about that, they might ask you about that, anything. But it's a smooth experience. There's it's very fairly done. Yeah.
When you mentioned that one should know the judge where you want to work with, under whom you want to work with, and you have to know the way they function, how can we know that? Like, how should we research? Should we read their judgments, or how should we?
No, reading their judgments will only tell you how well they write.
Right. So how can we know that? How the research should be conducted?
I think you'll have to get in touch with people who are clerking with them, who've clerked with them before, whether it's through your own network of people or someone that you know now. For example, the two of us. And eventually you could find out if it's conducive or if it's beneficial to clerk with a particular judge. And then you can take a call if it's worth applying to that person at all. Because, see, like I was pointing out, it's a choice. Let's say if there was an individual who had a choice between two, three judges because of the connections, that person could make that choice. Then there could be a person whether I should do this or I should straight away take a job at a firm. Then a lot of financial aspects will also come to play. That, okay, do I need this or not? Then there are choices, let's say, for example, I was talking about colleges. So automatically choices go lower when you've not come from a very, very reputed institution, regardless of how your grades are. Firms, of course, would prefer that. In that scenario, I think something like this, regardless of which judge it is, would help. Because it's going to also give you an opportunity of interacting with different individuals over there. Like, a lot of good friends that I have are some of the people who clerked with me and who were practicing at the time with different senior advocates or at the firm. And those individuals eventually helped me in making the choices which at the bar when I wanted to join a chamber. So those kind of things will start happening. And you never know, a judge might also be generous enough and help you out with making these choices. There are all sorts of people. So, but yeah, it can happen through those mechanisms. You'll have to go to court. You'll have to see if the judge really has. There are judges who never had their clerks in court because they buried them with so much work. But for some people, that's okay. For some people, that's not okay. Like, I wouldn't have been okay with not going to court. But there were people who were okay. And they're all doing well in profession. So it's not... It's necessary, but about what you really want.
Thank you.
So can you elaborate on what is the difference between doing clerkship in High Court and Supreme Court, and which is better option?
Yeah, so I'll try to detail it out for you. So no, there's nothing like better, according to me. I think because the work that's happening at High Court, again, so when you're applying at High Court, you have to be a little aware of how they function. Because, and also, what is the kind of roster that they mostly have? Because there are some judges in High Court who, because of their experience as either senior advocates or members of the bar, have had an experience in certain areas of law. So the Chief Justice would give them those kind of assignments more. And that automatically makes your learning better. For example, if a couple of my friends clerked with a person who was dealing with original side, arbitration, IPR. So they're learning from that perspective. And by the way, if you're looking to learn the work at that level where drafting happens, High Court is a much better option. Because that's, in a way, the work from where the matter is coming up. That's where it's created. Whatever has been done correctly or has been missed out determines the fate of the case eventually. The kind of drafting that happens at Supreme Court is very different. It's very, very from the perspective of questions of law, substantial question, general importance, constitutional importance, public policy, all of those factors come in. So that's very different from what happens at the High Court. So if you're really wanting to learn, then working with one of the original side judges at the Delhi High Court or senior judges who's listening to a lot of different miscellaneous writs or something is extremely beneficial. Because the kind of experience that they have had
because most of these individuals would have spent a lot of time at the bar, at that very court, the same court, mostly. So automatically, I think it's a very enriching experience. And Supreme Court's more about laying down law. So again, drafting-wise, I think that was a better place to be. But learning-wise, both the places are extremely good.
You can add.
See, just to add to this, again, the difference here is about the original side and the appellate side practices, right? So in Supreme Court, whatever work you're doing, the record is in front of you. Someone else has worked on it, arguments have been made, and a judgment has been delivered, right? In High Court, whatever you do, you are creating the record. You pick which are the arguments to choose, right? And if you clerk with a High Court judge, you will see many more options like that. You will see much more variety in the arguments that are taken. Because at the Supreme Court level, for most issues, the arguments are only on points of law, where there's not much scope for creativity. But at the High Court level, it's about application of those legal points to the facts of the specific case, right? So if you want to learn these things, then that way High Court would probably be a better option also. But see, the other thing that you have to understand, this is in relation to your question as well as yours, is that there's no fixed template, there's no one-size-fits-all formula. Your choices will depend on your background, your circumstances, and what you want to do in life. There are people that you might be brilliant and not interested in litigation at all. You might want to just work in a corporate firm, in which it might not make that much sense to go for a clerkship. I would still recommend it because it's a great experience. If you want to learn, it makes you a better lawyer eventually. But depending on what you want, that is important. Right. So, for example, you asked what are the options, or like which areas one should work for if you want to go. See, eventually you have to factor in your interests that as well. You can't just be dictated by where will I get a job, what will. So you might get a job in like an IPR firm, but you might hate IPR. Does that mean you'll spend the rest of your life doing IPR? So that's the question, right? So these are things that you have to figure it out and take. Factor everything in and speak to as many people as possible. Like your point about how do you research, figure out, browse through LinkedIn, like scour through LinkedIn, figure out who is interned where, who has spoken to, just pester them. If you find out one contact, ask them if they can put you in touch with someone who's worked at a particular office, then speak to them. These are things that you absolutely need to do.
So only one small aspect that I don't really agree with. I don't think there's no creativity or lack of creativity at Supreme Court. The only difference is at High Court you would see lawyers give you different kind of facts, different scenarios, interpret them differently, present to your judge differently, and then you would see him decide how he is dealing with the matter or how he's deciding it. So you see an entire stage of how an original side trial happens. If you're on the criminal side, then you'll see that aspect. At Supreme Court, on the other hand, I think how each and every high court in this country and every district court will function is decided. Because they're telling you whether this law, which was decided in this year, is still good law. So there, I think, is a lot of creativity with regard to how your law has to evolve. So yeah, you had a question in between. You had a question? No? Okay. Yeah, go on.
Sir, you said doing clerkship will make you a better lawyer eventually. Can you just justify that? Like, tell me if you...
No, we can't. We can't justify that. Most of the certificates you have at Supreme Court, most of the legends you have, they never clerked. Yeah.
So what are those specific learning objectives that we can one can look for when doing a judicial clerkship? What are those specific learning objectives that we can look for while doing a judicial clerkship? Like top five things that you can say.
There's nothing like top five things. See, it's just a different opportunity. This is something that was prevalent in US. Eventually it came here. Earlier, we didn't know about it because mostly it was kept for a limited number of colleges. Eventually it was thrown open. It was not actually limited for them, but it was only happening through connections. So
once more people knew about it, I think there were more opportunities for everyone to get in. And they created more spots. It became a more regular thing. There were a lot of judges who were not doing it at all. Then they started doing it. It's the same thing, I think, in this profession, that you just keep on reading as much as you can. You learn as much law, you absorb as much law as you can. If you want to argue in courts, then you try to see what kind of craft you really like, because there is so much wide variety. There are people who are extremely calm. There are people who are extremely assertive. There are people who can, who, it's, according to me, it's magic what those guys do over there. In the kind of matters that I have seen, meet many of their wives, want to get extremely passionate about point. I would say I had the privilege of watching these couple of matters, NJAC, the governor's controversy in Arunachal Pradesh. I even I saw the entire hearing, which was not even in the court that I was attached to. It was in another court, but I was very fortunate to work with the person who allowed me to do that as well. So I saw entire Aadhaar hearing when it was happening before the first bench, Justice Chalameshwar's bench. And I think how Mr. Diwan and Mr. Subramaniam and these guys argued at that point of time for defending the fundamental rights of, well, all of us, was one of the most extraordinary things I have ever seen in my life. They were so passionate about it, and the way they did it, the research that went into it, the number of people who were working on these briefs, it was amazing to watch. That in itself, I think, was an extraordinarily enriching experience for me. So that's what you're really there for. There's nothing like top five. Wherever you go, you have to work hard, you have to read more, you have to apply yourself. It's all there. There's nothing like top five. You just have to make sure that you get as much time as you can without annoying the judge. That's all. Like, you have to think before you approach them. You can't ask. Like, you, according to me, you shouldn't waste their time. So as long as you make sure that whatever you're about to ask them takes care of that aspect, that's the only test, according to me. If you're not wasting their time, then it's okay.
Think whatever comes to mind, even if it's now that we're here, whether it's clerkship or something else also that you want to ask about, it's fine.
Can you tell me something?
You should always be up for asking questions wherever you are.
Thank you. So that when you mentioned if it is even beyond clerkship, then I wanted to, I'm actually not well versed with how international law is being implemented in our country. Is it there? Okay. Okay. Is it just in theory that we are taught?
It has its uses.
Okay.
Various places, trade negotiations, bilateral treaties, investment, a lot of that is happening.
Okay.
You'll have to look for people who are more of an expert in those areas. I think you should consider browsing through LinkedIn a bit.
Okay.
Because there you'll find people who are specifically working in those areas. And then you could pick. But I'm guessing people like Amal Clooney do a lot of extraordinary work for human rights. A lot of other people also.
But in your experience in courts, did you come across any cases?
Having the knowledge of how a particular law functions in another country
plays a huge role at our Supreme Courts.
When they're deciding anything, and let's say there's a vacuum, then lawyers are expected to assist the court with all sorts of proceedings. Whether they're from medieval history or in another country, whether it's US, UK, Australia, wherever it is, there could be a country which is far smaller
than us in GDP, and even let's say they must have received their independence also recently. But they might be doing something right, and we'll adopt that. So that option is there in all these mechanisms, in all these constitutional hearings which have happened or are happening right now also. For example, Aadhaar also. There was a lot of literature, lot of information that they provided to the court, which has already happened in other countries like United States. So it's very useful.
knowing the various principles, knowing whether it's your VCLT, whatever it is, international obligations under UN, different WTO agreements, whatever it is, depending on the kind of matter, knowing those things definitely helps, because it helps the court to practically deal with a problem which they're probably facing for the first time and draw a parallel and see how, in Indian context, it could best apply.
I think mostly he's covered everything that had to be said in this. See, nothing that you learn will ever go to waste, right? So even if it deals with another jurisdiction or if it deals with a completely different set of law, you learn how those laws functions in that country, right? So, and that will help your understanding of basically how laws function. And that can be applied in our jurisdiction as well. So yeah, I think he comprehensively covered it.
And also, sir, when a person starts practicing, there are multiple different types of cases or different types of experiences that happen. So a person learns eventually. So is it advisable to enter the practice or working field immediately and not pursue masters? Masters somewhere, I'm not sure, but I'm getting this indirect hints that somehow it goes in a lot in theory and academic side, because if it's endless learning that a person can enter the working field and learn eventually as per the requirement of the field.
See, so this is again completely based on my interactions with folks who have done masters, both right after graduation and after getting some work experience. In most cases, the ones who went right after graduation said that they would have probably gotten more out of the experience had they had some work ex. Because if you go for an international master's, your class would essentially consist of experienced people. There you would be one of the few people who have just there without right after graduation, right? So, and again, this is based on only on interactions. I have not done a master's and I am not planning to do one. So I don't know, but.
So yeah, there's this, the point that he mentioned, it's also vice versa. People who go straight away, they say, oh, I think would have learned more if you would have gone after WorkEx. The ones who go after WorkEx would sometimes tell you that, you're completely out of touch and now again you put yourself into it and then you take a break from the profession, it becomes very difficult. Especially if you're in litigation, you will hear this a lot. They'll say that you should just get it out of your way. Why will you take a break eventually and then go back and then come? But I don't think it makes a difference. I think you can do it however you want. Okay, first of all, I haven't done it. So my conversation is based on a lot of my friends who've done it.
So
one factor that I think should matter is that are you taking your best shot? If you apply if you apply while you're in college, when you're in your final year and you apply and you get through one of the best universities in the world, whether it's in UK or US, then very well, you can go and pursue it according to me, because it gives you that impetus that you can continuously finish your studying and then get back to working. But if you think that this is not the best college I can do, and it will be if it's not one of those top 5 or 10 institutions, then I think it makes a lot of sense, because you'd be spending the same amount of money and it's a huge investment. So then it might be better that you take some time, and after those 2, 3, or 4 years of work ex, when you take your shot, you automatically will see that, because there are institutions which have a minimum work ex requirement, 2 years, 3 years. So it automatically makes you look more desirable to them. So I would recommend that you see what is best for you from that perspective. That are you taking your best shot? Is this how you can best spend that money, whether it's scholarship, whether it's family money, whatever it is. If you think that it's being best spent, if you're already getting Oxford, Harvard, Cambridge, Columbia, whatever it is, very well. If you're not, then maybe wait for those 2, 3 years, then attempt 3, 4 years, whatever it is. And at that point in time, whatever you're getting is the best you can do. Because I don't think you can go beyond wasting a lot of more. I mean, you cannot go beyond waiting. But yeah, there are people who've done it after 4 years. There are people who've done it after 6 years. And
I wanted to know how advisable it is to even do it, not like immediately after or 2, 3 years after.
I think I would advise it.
that you should do it. Again, it's the same thing because you're getting to be part of a different group altogether. And I think the change that comes is more in your approach and how your thinking can be broadened. I wouldn't say that it offers the same advantage that it used to 30 years back, because there was a time when only a number or handful of students were going from India to pursue these studies. And that, of course, put them in a different league altogether. Now there are hundreds of students going every year. There are like 10, 20% of some institutions is Indians. So it may not be the same level, but personally I look at it in this manner, that if eventually the Indian economy was to be opened to foreign law firms, then I think people who have spent some time over there or are working there or have come back after studying there would be in a more advantageous position than the rest of us. So I would definitely recommend it.
Thank you.
Also, I must say that when you're looking at jobs at the firms, it does not reflect much in your pay. You might go, you might study at Harvard, you might come back, and if you want to practice, that chamber is not suddenly going to start paying you more just because, oh, you came from Harvard.
Some seniors did mention, and I got to know. That is why I posed the question.
Yes, so that is not related.
Yes, you. It's a.
It will stay where it was.
Right, right. Yeah. It's a never-ending learning process. So that is why I posed this question, that if you have to learn, and then when you're working, you learn eventually side by side. So why not learn and experience new things as per the requirement of the job, whatever is coming your way. So that is why I wanted to know how beneficial it is to pursue masters in a particular field and specialization, and instead working and then learning side by side.
No, see, the latter is going to continue all your life.
Right.
But that 1 year, what you will do over there is different.
Okay.
That is not something that I think you will have an opportunity of doing it over here just because you're here and you're working.
Okay.
And I think it's a great thing that it's a never-ending learning process, because it's basically people are paying you to read. That's what this profession is. I mean, in litigation at least.
Yeah.
So I think that's a great thing, regardless of the recent events of how disappointing they have been from the perspective of profession. That's one of the advantages, that all the investment is done. Now what you have to focus is on, I mean, of course, bringing in work itself is a huge challenge sometimes, but yeah. I would definitely recommend a master's if you have the time, funds, whatever it is, and if you can take your best shot. If you get a good college, you should definitely go. Yeah.
Thank you.
If I want something a little more than academic pursuit out of LLM, would you still recommend doing an LLM outside of the country, considering law is still a very subjective thing from government to government, right? So if I do an LLM out of a NLU in this country, would I be faring better than if I do an LLM?
So my entire suggestion was based on you doing a LLM abroad, by the way.
Yeah.
Whatever I've said till now. The country thing, I have no idea. It's a good experience, fun experience. Some people enjoy staying in those colleges, but...
Do you look at LLM as purely an academic pursuit, or is there practical purpose to LLM?
I don't see it as just an academic pursuit. I think there's potential in it, because again, one was, of course, I said, if the economy opens. Two, if you want to work abroad at all, if you want to have any chance, you will have to do that. In fact, I think people who've gone for masters also now, because the situation is US so bad, even in UK, most of the people who studied at Harvard or Columbia also cannot find jobs over there. So for that too, I think you'll have to do law over there, the Juris Doctor program that they have. And a couple of my friends have done that. There was this one guy who finished 5 years of law with me. He wanted to go after 3 years, but Mumbai University did not give him that graduation certificate. So he couldn't. So he did those 5 years, then he went there, he did JD, and then he got a job over there. But again, there are people who went from GLC straight away, went to Harvard, and they got a job there. They've cleared New York bar and everything. But it's tough. Getting a job abroad right now is really tough. But see, it's the reason why I showed you that benefit is if 10 years later the government says that, okay, fine, foreign law firm's in, at that point of time you can't go abroad and do a master's. But if you've already done it and if you've already forged those relationships or connections over there, then I think it might come in handy at some point in time. And regardless, it's exactly, so see, if you have the funds and everything can be arranged, then I think you should definitely do it. It's definitely going to be worth it, for sure. It puts you in a different league, for sure. Not that people who are not going for it will not be successful. I think it improves chances also. It can, because I think there's more potential. There's no guarantee in either of the sides. The ingredients which will take you to that road are many. There are people who started at trial court and they've made it in the profession. There are people who started at high court. There are people who started at Supreme Court. There are people who started with a job. There are people who started at the age of 37 and they're running one of the most sought after law firms in the country. So there's nothing of the sort. You could start at any point and achieve whatever it is that you desire. You've got to, everyone's been dealt a different set of cards. So you just play your hand. Any more thinking faces? I think everyone done. We'll conclude this. Anything that comes to mind, feel free. It's fine. Cities also, if you want, it's okay.
So, as judicial clerks, did you actually have? Were you able to sit with the judges in the closed door brainstorming sessions? Like, for example, in this Ayodhya case, these guys have gone into like closed door meeting over like deciding what's going to happen in the case. So as a clerk,
the clerk decided what will happen.
No. As in for example, in the Ayodhya case, where the judges are like, now the next 7, 10, whatever days, we're going to go inside, we're going to figure out what we're going to do with this case, right? Are the clerks allowed into those?
ऐसा नहीं हो रहा है कि सात दिन ले रहे हैं कि अब डिसाइड करेंगे.
नहीं, as in
judges are doing this.
True. Are you allowed in, like as a clerk?
No.
Okay.
No. I've seen a couple of judges arrive, who were hearing the matters, but it's all inside. You're not part of that gathering. You don't deserve to be part of that gathering, frankly. So, because see, you are attached to one person, and you can't suddenly be made a part of the gathering where those five individuals are there because they don't have a clue of who this person is. And plus, you're all there's a lot of secrecy, confidentiality. They have that Official Secrets Act, which is applicable to you. All of that happens. You're not supposed to talk about it or share about it because those are extremely serious issues. You don't even know, actually, frankly. It's not like you come to know, oh, this is the verdict. There are some people who do, who rely on their clerks from that perspective, because I told you that there are some who might have told them to write also. But not my experience, for sure.
Yeah, in most cases, you will not be part of those closed door meetings. In most cases, you will not even know that these sessions have happened or something, right? Because you are there to help them, and your job is to do what they ask you. So it's a one-way flow of information in almost every case.
One thing that I just add, which has nothing to do with clerkship as such, if you guys have time, then I think you should, and you're interested towards litigation, then you should definitely consider interning at the Bombay High Court and observing the counsels over there. Because I personally believe the counsels over there, like Mr. Darayas Khambata, Mr. Janak Dwarkadas, Mr. Aspi Chinoy, Mr. Iqbal Chagla, Zal, Andhiyarujuna, Rohan Kama, these guys are just the best counsel that you will come across in this profession. So the Bombay Bar, from that perspective, I think is worth observing. They have a very different system, actually. So here it's direct practice, right? Client comes to you, you draft, you prepare, you go brief, or you argue. Over there, firms do this entire part. and counsels argue in the court.
The distinction between the solicitor and
they
the
have
pastor,
it in
Calcutta
also.
They have it in Bombay.
It was
they
a British thing.
As well, I think.
Yeah, but it's not that operational.
But in both these bars, it's still quite rough.
The way it's forced in Bombay is something that I've not seen before. And it used to be that solicitors will prepare the brief, draft, do everything, deal with the client, and then they will engage a counsel who will argue and present the case. So they've continued with the same system in a way. It's not that the solicitor will do it now, there are lawyers and law firms, and counsels will only argue. So there could be a person who would be doing 10 briefs at the age of 29, 30, or 31 also, regularly arguing so many matters, and not bothered about what little work is happening in your filing and all of that. Delhi is different from that perspective. But and I think that is the reason, because they've had more practice. Here, a person would become that kind of a counsel and would have those many briefs only beyond 40. There are very few individuals who have it at 38, 39, 40, and mostly it's beyond 45, 50, so on and so forth, when they become seniors. I'm comparing those two, yes. Senior is different. Senior is everywhere. That's happening in almost every court right now. But over there, it happens much before. There is a clear divide. So even if I have a matter, and I'm the filing attorney at a firm, whether it's Khehar, J.S. or whatever, and it's a smaller matter, forget the senior, I will still engage a junior counsel to argue that brief. That's the culture there. So yeah, I think you should consider that. Much better, they're officers of the court. They don't lie, they don't cheat. They're very upfront. It's very different. They don't try to pull a fast one on the court. Because I was in Bombay for 5 years. I did a firm as a paralegal, and then I just worked with different counsels. Dr. Saraf was one of them. Again, an amazing chamber. Mr. Andhiharujuna was one of them. Rohan Kama was one of them. So I would definitely recommend those guys. Just to, even if you don't have an opportunity of interning with them, just go there and follow those guys in court. I think you'll have a great time.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having us. All the best to you guys.